So I'm now here with Richard Carson, who holds the chair in cognitive neuroscience of aging at the Department of Psychology and the Institute of Neuroscience in Trinity College Dublin, which I know well. Welcome, Richard. So we're going to have 5 minutes. If you set the clock for 5 minutes, and we'll have an alarm when we stop. So when did you get into transcranial magnetic stimulation?
When did I get first visited? Went back to Vancouver. And were let loose in a lab that had a TMS machine, myself and a colleague. And we were interested in pathways that mediated bimanual coordination. And knowing virtually nothing about it, we spent half an hour using a single pulse TMS stimulator on each other.
And published?
No, not at that stage. So then the person whose machine we had borrowed came out to Brisbane the year after, and we ran some further studies and I did publish something on the basis of that after.
And what were you working on in Vancouver?
Well, in Vancouver I was just visiting for a conference, but in Brisbane at that time we were particularly interested in bimanual coordination, and particularly interested in how movement on one side of the body gave rise to an influence on the opposing side.
So what was your first finding? What was the first thing that made you think, yeah, I'm gonna pursue this methodology?
Well, I think was that it gave us the opportunity to look at those interactions at a different level. Because previously we had used techniques such as H reflex recordings that allowed us to look at interactions at the spinal cord level, and the single pulse TMS allowed us to look at projections from both vortex. So it really gave us a new set of insights that could enhance our understanding of the mechanisms involved.
Yeah. And what did you move into after that? Did you move from Brisbane back to the UK, or?
First to Belfast. Yeah. But really, during my time in Brisbane, I then started becoming interested in stroke rehabilitation. And I think one of the more exciting applications of TMS in that context was looking at the integrity of corticospinal projections in stroke survivors before and after an intervention, a clinical intervention, and being able to I guess recognize that those measurements had some prognostic utility, and were able to differentiate between responders and non-responders.
And in TMS, do you think that's the main thing that can be offered to the stroke field, which are measures of improvement and predictors of improvement, or do you think there's actually a role in therapeutic stages for magnetic stimulation?
Personal view at this stage is it offers more as a prognostic tool, probably in combination with measures of structural connectivity, so DTI based measures and so on. I think my dabbling in non-invasive brain stimulation as an intervention was driven by an initial belief that it may have utility as an intervention along with movement based therapy. My experience over the last few years has led me to be, I'm careful whether I use the word cynical, skeptical, or guarded, but I think I'm much more careful now about what I believe is the potential of the various forms of stimulation in the context of stroke rehabilitation in particular.
Yeah. No, it's proved really, really very difficult. And what's your big thing now? What are you working on at the moment?
Other than being cynical and skeptical.
Standard.
Yeah, well, I have an interest, I suppose I've reverted back to more original interest in using movement as the tool for rehabilitation rather than brain stimulation. So we're particularly interested in the rehabilitation of older people who have suffered a fracture of the upper limb as a result of falls. So often we think of falls as people having hip fractures, but in fact more than half of the older people who fall suffer a fracture of the upper limb, and you can understand why that's the case when they reach out to arrest their falls. And for people who are very close to a disability threshold already, a period of 4-6 weeks in which they have an arm immobilized in a cast can lead to them being below the disability threshold and consequential impact upon quality of life and independence. So we're looking at whether we can develop protocols, training protocols that can be used using the non-cast limb during that period that lead to a preservation of functional capacity in the opposite limb, so that when they come back after the cast taken off, they have much less of a loss of functional capacity.
And do you use brain stimulation as a measure?
We do. That's part of the sort of battery of measures we use. So we're interested not only in the phenomenon, we're also interested, as you might expect, in the mechanisms that mediate that. And I think understanding more of the mechanisms gives you the opportunity to refine your intervention, hopefully in a principled way, rather than, well, let's see if this works.
5 minutes, that's it.
God, don't fly quickly.
Yeah, I told you, I warned you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.